Welcome. Welcome, everybody. So we are very happy to have our keynote speaker tonight. You know, we had to delay a little bit due to the weather, but everything happened. So it's a real pleasure for me tonight to host Chris Fabian, who co-created and co-led the UNICEF Innovation Unit in New York since 2007. So this unit, the objective of this unit is to identify, to promote, to develop, and to scale up technologies for application to kids, and to help UNICEF to operate in a better way in operating environments that are often very difficult and may benefit from new technologies and development. So this innovation unit has gained global recognition with many awards, including one of the top 50 innovations of 2011 from the Time magazine, and in 2012, a gold and silver IDSA award, and a Red Hat prize for being one of the three top open source projects recently. So no doubt that the UNICEF Innovation Unit has made UNICEF a global leader in innovation for development. Christopher is very well known for his work in identifying, mentoring, and promoting local leaders, designers, engineers, and innovators around the world. He holds a degree in philosophy from the American University in Cairo and in media studies from the New School in New York. And in 2013, he was recognized as one of the Times Magazine 100 most influential people. So welcome, Christopher, and the floor is yours now for your wonderful keynote, I'm sure. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. I was told that I would blind the audience if I made my slides have a white background. So please have sunglasses ready, because there are a few of them that might be a bit painful. I wanted to talk about four things tonight. And I wanted to sort of describe a set of problems that we at UNICEF think are so important and so compelling that we have a team of really incredible people focused on solving them. And then to talk a little bit about some of the solutions and the ways that we approach what we think are the biggest problems facing humanity today. This is our team in New York. We have another group of about 30 people around the world. And this team doesn't necessarily look like people you would associate with UNICEF or with the United Nations. It's a team of weirdos and nerds and ne'er-do-wells who come from private sector, from tech startups, from space of design and entrepreneurship. And it sits within this big organization. Is that blinding enough? That's for emphasis. It sits within a huge organization. UNICEF is a vast creature. It's 70 years old as of this year. It has about a $5.5 billion a year budget. And it's made up, as part of the UN system, of people who are used to working with governments, used to working at the speed that governments work, which is generally slow. The team of people that I'm lucky enough to work with comes from a world of very fast-paced change, of action, of science and data as a backing for doing things, and generally moves quite quickly. And so a lot of what we try to do is to balance out a fast speed of development and technology and innovation with a speed of policy change that we know is really the only way to make things scale and make things work. And the type of issues that we work on are big ones. So we identified at the beginning of last year, we sort of tried to solidify what we're working on in our team. And we look at issues like urbanization. We know that by 2030, you're gonna have about 75% of people living in cities around the world. And we as UNICEF are very poorly equipped to deal with that, as are most governments. So you either have old cities that aren't built at all to deal with the number of people who will be living in them, or you have synthetic cities that are often built in a way that doesn't really fit the needs of their populations. And if you look at a place like the Mukuru slums, these very poor areas in Kenya and Nairobi, they're half a kilometer away from the wealthiest set of houses in the city, and you've got 8 people living in a space that's like 3 by 3 meters, and the number of things that are suffered in that area are the same types of issues that UNICEF had focused on 20 years ago in a rural area. We also have issues like migration. So right now there are about 52 million children who are on the move because of violence and war. And that's an inconceivable number. I think it's very hard to conceptualize 52 million humans. 52 million children whose lives have been upended by war and violence is difficult to describe or to think about in any way. But we know that this is not something that's reducing. We know that the issues that we're seeing around the world that force children from their homes aren't getting less, they're not becoming fewer. And we know that we, as an organization which was built to deal with sovereign states, with the 135 countries that we work in, that we're not able to deal with a mass of humans who aren't attached to a government. So that means that UNICEF needs to go through a real thought change and a real existential change, and that's hard for a big organization to do. We also know that there are about 500 million kids who aren't going to get the right food, the right type of nutrition in the next few years because of lack of water, lack of crop irrigation, lack of the right food for the crops, leading to the right food for kids, and about 180 million kids. And again, these numbers are so big that they're essentially meaningless. 180 million kids who aren't going to be able to get the right access to nutrition because of too much water. So we've broken the planet, right? There's one more depressing one, and then all the fun stuff happens, promise. Two more depressing ones. We've broken the planet, and we're not actually creating a workforce of young people who are ready to solve the problems that have been created. So if you look at a country like Malawi, where I was just last month, you have about 18 million people in Malawi right now. By 2030, that's going to be 40 million people. Half of those are going to be under 18. And the major hope for Malawi economically is a coal factory that's being built now. And that doesn't scale. The type of skills that are being taught in schools, the type of opportunities that are being made available, are not at all equipping us to deal with these types of problems. The last one, there, that's blinding. Look out for the mosquito. And we also know that the world is more connected now than it ever was before. So when we're facing things like the Zika outbreak or the Ebola epidemic, suddenly the world has become something that is more tightly connected, which is almost a good thing, because suddenly we're all more aware of problems that might have seemed very far off 10 or 15 years ago, and those problems spread quickly. So these are the class of issues that our team looks at. And as we're trying to figure out how to deal with things that are, like, this is depressing stuff, right? This is, you happy you came at 7 o'clock to listen? Yeah. As we're looking at these, we only see a few spaces where we can create the leverage that we need in order to solve them. So let me talk about some opportunities that we see. Population growth is starkly different in different parts of the world. So you have places like West Africa, particularly Nigeria, Senegal, Mali, that are going to account for the bulk of population growth over the next 15 to 20 years. You also have some parts of the world with decreasing populations. So this starts to make a map for us of where we can focus as a small team, a team of 30 nerds in New York and another 30 around the world, where we can focus our efforts and our small amount of time and resources to make global change. This is data, and data is really helpful, I think, because it allows you to make decisions that are smarter than if you don't have data. Our budget, right, $5.5 billion a year, seems huge. It seems really, really big. You take it over the next 3 years, it's about $18 billion. China's investment as a single country in the continent of Africa is about $80 billion, $65 to $80 billion, depending on how you count it, over the same time. And there's an arrogance that comes to working in a big organization, in working in the UN. There's an arrogance in working in governments as well. And that arrogance comes from thinking that things are going to keep going the way that they have. And if you look at this, the only way that we can leverage that small amount of money compared to the amount that countries are spending on overseas development in whatever form is by being smart and is by using data to look at where we can find cracks in a world that's breaking very quickly. So here's a crack. Here are numbers of people. So let's call everybody in this chart a citizen or a netizen. That's a horrible word. It's like webinar. Awful. There are more people on Facebook than there are in China. There are more people using Tencent's family of chat apps than there are in India. There are more people on WhatsApp than there are in the US. And that number's kind of like interesting if you're looking at it just from a quantitative point of view, just as numbers. But if you start to look at the type of services that are being provided on those platforms, it becomes more interesting. You're able to send money from one place to another. You're able to provide education. Facebook knows who you are better than you do. You know, so Facebook, you know when you look at like a pair of shoes somewhere on the internet and then they follow you around everywhere and then they end up on your Facebook feed? That's because Facebook is super creepy about how much it knows about you. Facebook knows that you're going to break up with somebody 2 weeks before you know it. True. They've got a great data blog because of how your behavior changes. So the type of data that's being generated by all of these platforms and the type of services that they're providing is exponential compared to what a government 30 years ago could have possibly conceived they would have from censuses, like your census happens every 10 years, from the forms that people fill out when they pay their taxes. Like that type of data is nothing compared to this. Let me show you how much nothing. You like that? That one's really bright. The dark red here is structured data. So those are things like a census, like a survey that's done in order to know about people. The problem is that people lie on censuses, and censuses are really slow. And so are household surveys of any type. That orange, the black dot up there, is actually really, it's bigger than it should be. That's the amount of data that's held in the US Library of Congress, including all of its digital assets. Right, see the black dot underneath the D of unstructured data? And the orange is your shoes that are following you around on Facebook. And this is important, because we work with systems, sovereign states, governments, international organizations that are used to working with that red type of data. Right? That's what you do. If you're a statistician, you take structured information and you make decisions on it and then you act. But that data is already 3 to 4 years old, if not more, by the time you're acting on it. And if you're trying to find out about a group of young people from Aleppo who are now in southern France, there's no census that you can take data from that happened that will tell you anything about them. So suddenly this provides us with an opportunity as well, right? If we're looking for those leverage points and where we focus our time and our money and our brains, suddenly we can start to see beginnings of hope. Whew, that's more relaxing. Sunglasses off. So I want to talk about a platform that we've built and then give two or three other examples of how we're using this type of real-time data to drive change in the world and specifically in the countries that we're working in. There's a platform called UReport, and you can find out more about this and about the other platforms that I'll show you by Googling them. These are all open source technology stacks. These are all built in the countries that they're being used in. And they're all providing us as UNICEF with an ability to have better real-time data for action. So UReport is very simple. The premise behind it is that young people, anybody, would rather send a text message than have a phone call for a variety of reasons. It's cheaper. You don't have to talk to your parents for so long. You can just send a little thing. And it allows you to interact with a whole bunch of people at once. In a place like Uganda, where within 2 years of launching the system, we had 300,000 users, we were able to ask questions over a basic mobile phone, a phone that somebody already has, a Nokia 1100, and get answers back in real time from young people in order for us to act. So just to talk about an example of how this has actually been rolled out in real life, this is the scariest trip I've ever been on. This was in 2014, at the end of 2014, when the Ebola epidemic was at its peak, and our team was asked to take that same system, simple SMS for getting information back and forth, and see if we could set it up in Liberia. Liberia was at the heart of the Ebola epidemic, and the biggest problem that we had there is we couldn't get data about what we needed to do. You couldn't send a car, it took too long. You couldn't use census data, people had moved or died. There weren't health workers to call. So the idea was, could you use young people as actual reporters of data? And this is what they gave us when we went to Liberia during Ebola. You got a thermometer to take your temperature, and if it ever was above 36 in the morning, you're sort of freaking out. And you got a sheet that said, if you're bleeding from your eyes, there's a problem. And that was it. They're like, go. And we went because we thought it was important. And what we found is that, just like anywhere else in the world, what you see on the TV and the media is not what you see on the street. So there are some kids playing football. This is a room of people from the Ebola Command Center trying to figure out how to use the small amount of data that they had for action. This is a map. So this map was generated every week based on data that was already a few weeks old that showed where the most cases were being reported. But if you have cases of Ebola in a place where you don't want people to come in, you don't want these people in scary suits to come into your community, you don't report them. So this data is already flawed. And if you're trying to get down to Maryland in the bottom right from, I don't know, from anywhere up in the north, from Monrovia, for example, that doesn't look like it's very far, but that would take you about 4 days by car because the roads are wiped out. So this is the sort of information density that we were dealing with. That's a girl cooking fish because life goes on, even in the worst of times. And this is your information poverty in a place like Monrovia during Ebola. This is a newsstand, and the guy who runs this stand gets one copy of the New York Times every day, 2 days, and he copies the information that he thinks is pertinent from the New York Times and writes it up on a big chalkboard. And on this blackboard, you can see this is another guy walking to work with his kid. He's reading the headlines from the New York Times. And the person who runs this news kiosk has also printed out a few photos. And for a while, he was keeping score of Ebola versus the US. So it was like Ebola 2, US 0. So that was going up on the top left-hand corner. And this was the amount of information that you could get as somebody in the capital city in the middle of an epidemic. And if we think about the number of kilobytes that are contained on this, like what's your kilobytes per person per day if you're looking at that thing? What do we have access to with our smartphones? If people are getting sick, you can just look up some information about it. You can even send information back. You can ask a question. Maybe there's like 20 kilobytes of information on that blackboard, maybe 30. It depends on the resolution of those photos. And it's like resolve rate and its refresh rate is super, super slow, right? So that's the type of information poverty that we find. And that's not, you don't only find that in a poor country or a poor city. You also find that in wealthy places where you have pockets of people without access to information. So what we did is we tried to get a bunch of young people together. And these were, all of these, the guys in the blue shirts, had been at the front line of the first part of the Ebola crisis. So these were young people who were, as their job, going house to house and trying to talk to people about the symptoms of this disease, about what to do. And remember, the baud rate, your KBPS for the country, was that. So these are like human modems, right? They're human interfaces, walking around community to community, helping people understand. And we asked them, we started saying, look, UNICEF really wants to know about whether or not you're washing dead bodies. Like, are young people involved in washing dead bodies? And they were like, you're crazy. So this is a user testing process. They were like, you're crazy, we're adolescents. We're like 16 years old. Only old people wash dead bodies. And we said, but UNICEF wants to know about, we want to ask you guys questions about washing dead bodies because we know that's a main vector for the disease to spread. And they said, we don't do that. Why would you ever think that? And I said, I don't know, somebody thought that in an office in New York and blah, blah, blah. And they said, no. And I said, so what are you concerned about? And they said, actually, our big problem is that we're stuck with the same group of people. All the schools have been closed. We can't meet our friends. We can't go out and hang out anywhere. And we're stuck in this horrible situation where we're actually not getting information from each other. We're not able to hang out, and we're not able to have fun. And the government had closed the schools about 2 months before this as a way to prevent the spread of the disease, which is either a good thing or a bad thing. And I mean, it's a good thing because you stop maybe disease from spreading in a school, but it's a bad thing because you close off the fundamental method for information to move in communities. So we brought some nerds, always good to have nerds. That's Evan, who basically, Evan rebuilt the whole Liberian telecom system because all of the engineers had left as soon as Ebola struck and had gone back either to China or to Sweden. And then Stuart is looking, I think he's looking very hungry at something. And he's looking at his hand washing. He had to wash your hands all over the place. And what we did is we built the first set of prototypes. And we walked around in communities. This is one of the communities that had been most affected by Ebola. And we walked around and we started doing user testing in the places where users were. And I think this is very important. It's very different to build a system where the need is than it is to build it somewhere far away and assume that you know anything, because we just find over and over again that we don't. As we were walking around in West Point, in this community, we found a bunch of kids sitting in the street in a school, in an informal school, in the mud, and it's about like 35 degrees, very humid, and they're sitting there working. Because the urge to educate, the urge to learn, and the urge to be connected is so strong that it perseveres even in really dire circumstances. And we asked our user testers also to do paper prototyping. So anybody who's been involved in a tech startup knows that if you don't test your thing very quickly with users all the time, it doesn't work. And so these young women were asking questions of various people in West Point and then copying down the information. And one thing that was very interesting is that we had a big problem. We always have problems with network operators. They're really hard to work with. They have their own agendas. And we had a problem getting the system up. We needed a short code, a free short code, so you can just text, 2442. And be part of the system. And it took us a long time to get that set up. And what these young women did, which was brilliant, and we hadn't thought of it at all, is as they were talking to people, they were getting their phone numbers. So even though we couldn't register them on the system at that moment, when we were doing the paper prototyping, we ended up with like 3,000 users before the system even launched. And that's the kind of thing that you can't figure out from far away. You have to be at the place where the problem is acute. in order to have those ideas, to understand things in that way. By the end of December of 2014, we had about 3,000 U reporters. By the end of last year, we had about 61,000 in Liberia. If you look right now at the website, there are about 103,000. It's just liberia.ureport.in. 103,000 young people. And last year, when there were about 60,000, we started hearing about issues of violence against students in schools. And we started hearing that teachers were asking students for favors in order to give their final grades. And violence against students is a problem everywhere in the world. It's not limited to a place like Liberia. But suddenly, we're seeing a problem. We're seeing a problem that we can gather data about. We have the agreement from the Ministry of Education and others to work with us to solve this problem, to set up the right police forces and hotlines. And we're able to ask, there's another really bright one, we're able to ask students a question, and within minutes, get back answers. And what we found is that 86% of people were saying that in their communities, in their schools, that teachers were committing acts of violence against them. We were also able to pinpoint exactly where that problem was most acute. And by having this data in real time, by being able to work with the ministry and present this to them in a way that they could get police action and legislative action, we were able to close the loop on a problem in weeks rather than in years or never. And this is the power of data and the speed of data that we can work with today. And that's a system that was built from something very different, from a very different set of needs, and we're using it now to ask questions about all sorts of things in Liberia. Another system that's built on the same basic code base is called MTRAC in Uganda. MTRAC's now in about 6 countries. Same idea, you can use a basic mobile phone to ask questions and get information back. In Uganda 4 years ago, if you went to a health center, if you're a mother and you went to a health center to get basic medicine to prevent your child from dying of malaria, basic medicine, Coartem, should have been available, 71% of the time, it would not be available. There was a stock out, the clinic doesn't have it. This is the way that data was collected before on stock of malarial medicines. So you write some stuff on paper, you send the paper up, 6 weeks later, 2 months later, a supply comes back. That's not the speed that humans have the need. That's a speed that maybe governments work at, but that doesn't work for us. Using this basic system for sending SMSs, we're able to do load balancing across clinics. So if one clinic doesn't have Coartem or ACTs, the guy maybe 3 kilometers away does and can send somebody on a bicycle. And it doesn't have to go up to the district for resupply. And being able to use data to do dynamic load balancing in a network isn't a complicated thing. There's no magic in that. But being able to use that and apply it to a problem, like 71% stockouts, has led us in Uganda move that number from 71% to 14% in 2 years. And that's a hefty change. That's an incredible change in terms of being able to move physical supplies around. Same thing with schools. A similar platform lets us ask a teacher a question. So, for example, this is in Malawi, and that's a head teacher of a school in Malawi, and that's the finger of a minister. Doesn't that look like a ministerial finger? Very. And what they're seeing at the ministry level is data that's coming in from schools in real time. Data about whether or not textbooks got delivered, whether or not teachers are in school on a given day, and very importantly, whether or not girls are in school on a given day. So one thing that we know is if there's a shock to a community, if there's a flood, if there's a food crisis, the first thing that happens in the community is that girls are pulled out of school. It's an incredible leading indicator or proxy indicator of exogenous shock in a community. With this system, you can see that happening in real time. You can then send somebody to see what's going on. You can make a phone call, and you can adjust the education system nationally in days. And this system is also being used to build curricula. So in several countries, we're asking teachers and young people what they want to be learning or teaching and learning, and building that into national redesign of curriculum because we have the data en masse and quickly. Finally, I think another thing that's very interesting in terms of the discussion around data is about registration. So a third of kids in the world, a third of young people, don't have a formal ID. They don't have a birth certificate. They don't have something that represents them, which doesn't necessarily sound that bad, and it isn't necessarily that bad unless you have a need to access a formal system, like you have a need to go to a health center or to get into a secondary school or if there's an emergency and you need to prove who you were. And if you don't have that formal ID, you're at most risk, particularly in an emergency, of health risks, of being left out of the system, of being trafficked. And these are things that having an ID, having something that links you to a national system, or at least to some system of people around you, helps with tremendously. In Uganda, the situation was even worse. There, it was 2/3 of kids didn't have any identity at all. And the reason is pretty simple, it's money. So if you're a poor mother and you give birth to a kid in a village and you maybe make $40 per month, or 50, and somebody says to you, hey, you've just given birth to this kid, and now we'd like you to go to another place, like go to a city, spend like 20 US, spend half of your monthly income to get there. By the time you get there, you're gonna see some guy with a black leather jacket who's gonna ask you for a little bit more money, because he knows you've just come all that way. And then later on, you're gonna get this piece of paper, which maybe lets your kid get into a university. Your ability to turn that very, very future optional value proposition into something that would make you give up a month's income is minimal. The incentive just isn't there. And so what we tried to do is see if there was a way to move that birth registration process closer to the mother. And it works really well. So what we did is basically using Android phones at a clinic level, start doing birth registration. And so what you see on the bottom line is the birth registration in Uganda nationally. So it was about 22% in 2007, 26% in 2009. Not very good, right? That's not like a great rate of change for that bottom line, even if it went as expected. We started working with health workers, with the people delivering babies, and saying to them, why don't you register that baby in real time with your Android phone? And you can actually print out a birth certificate very nearby the mother. And we introduced the system called Mobile VRS in 2009. 2010, 2011, there wasn't very much of a difference between that slope and the existing slope of birth registration nationally. It was a little bit, but it wasn't worth the amount of money that we were pouring into that project or the amount of time. And anybody who's done a startup also knows about those few years. Like, those are the years of pain, and you've borrowed all the money from your parents and your friends, and nobody picks up your calls anymore, and you've, like, eaten all the pizza. But something happened. And in about 2012, we started seeing an increase. And now, in 2015, you have 70% birth registration in a country that was predicted to have it at about 36%. And that's nationally. So that's not a small project. That's a national project with government buy-in and with the support of very basic technology. There's nothing complex about the technology. And so those are the type of things that we see as solving those big and depressing problems that I talked about at the beginning of this presentation. But if we don't have good data, we don't have any ability to create that symmetry. So what's this? This is a country, right? Country? We agree, yeah. This is a country in West Africa. This is Sierra Leone. And there's some borders around it, and there's some straight lines and other borders that people drew. That's how we see a country, but we, with our small minds, our human minds are not very good, I don't think, we see that as a country. Let's look at how people see it. So if you look at Sierra Leone and you look at mobile phone traffic, at CDR data sets of where people are on their phones, of who they're talking to, if you look at that kind of aggregate mobile traffic, you start to see communities appear that you don't see on this map. So, sorry for the blinding white, but anything that's colored the same is a community of people who talk with and interact with other people in that same color more than other colors. So you see the dark blue in the left and the dark blue in the top right. There are actually two cities there that are connected by a road. And that's a community of people who work in one area, live in another, and they go back and forth. That dark green area is one community of people. Maybe it's the same language group, maybe it's the same ethnic group, maybe it's the same religious group. But this is data that's gotten from aggregate phone records in real time. It's anonymous, so you're not looking at any individual person. But look at that community versus the ethnic boundaries that were drawn 200 years ago, or the administrative boundaries from 100 years ago. And think about how, if you're trying to plan your communications or your resources in an emergency, how you would do that planning. If you want to talk to people in the language that they speak, would you look at that boundary set, or would you look at what real-time data is showing you about who's speaking that language and who's interacting with whom? The other thing is that those patterns change day by day. And we know this. We know people don't sit in one place. They move. So this is that same map of Sierra Leone on a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And look at the pink, that pink on the corner, right, in the middle. So Friday, you've got that on Saturday there's a market, and on the Saturday market the pink spreads out, and on the Sunday people go back. If you were trying to position information about Ebola, if you're trying to say, here's information that you must know, but you need to do it in a specific language, where would you put it? If you don't have this data, you have no idea. But if you're able to get real-time data and use it to figure out where to put things, you can suddenly optimize a lot of work that is right now kind of based on guesswork. For example, this is a slide of asymmetry. So this is global asymmetry. You got in the green area, you've got 73% of the world's wealth and 14% of the world's population. In the gray area, 27% of the world's wealth and 86% of the population. The gold dots are, I don't know, Forbes magazine's 49 out of the top 50 top cities to live in, and Singapore is outside of it. And those red borders are the borders that we all know if you travel a lot, because when you go from the green to the gray, it's very easy. And when you go from the gray to the green, you get treated like an animal, and your bags get opened 20 times and all of that. And this is an interesting map because it talks to an asymmetry in the world. But it's not really a correct map, right? It sort of hints at something. But we know that there are parts of Toronto that have the same health indicators that you find in northern Senegal. There's city blocks in Toronto where you have large numbers of indigenous populations which just don't get the health care that every block around them is getting. So this is a nice map as a conceptual map, but it's not really based on real-time data. And it's certainly not based on granular data. This is a math slide that I put up to make me look smart. But this is not my math. This is what our research scientists work on in our team. Unemployment data is a really good indicator of economic data at a household level. And if you look at Spain, that's Spain. If you look at Spain, you can either look at census data about unemployment from 10 years ago and say, where are people employed or unemployed? And that's nice, but it's from 10 years ago, so it's automatically wrong. And it's also a census, so it's automatically iffy, because if you say to somebody, are you employed? Yes, no, they may tell you. If you say, are you employed in some kind of sketchy, semi-legal, soft employment, gray employment? No, I'm not employed at all, right? You get weird answers from people. This is Twitter data. On the bottom left is Twitter activity. So you see that red line is how you tweet if you are employed on a given day. If you're unemployed, you tweet the blue line. If you're employed, you go into the office, you've got a boss, they're super boring, so you're tweeting during the meetings, right? You, I don't know, go for a coffee break, you tweet. You have a different fingerprint if you're employed than if you're unemployed. We've proven that. Up on the top, you've got mobility. You move differently if you're employed than if you're unemployed. If you're unemployed, you go between your house and a place to find work. You pretty much go between two places, a little bit outside of that. If you're employed, you can go visit your friends, you go away somewhere on holiday, you can do all sorts of stuff. So you've actually got a different fingerprint of mobility too. When you combine those two, you get data about unemployment that's as accurate as the census. It's as accurate as that. This data took our data scientists about 3 weeks to crunch the first time. It cost $3,000. And it showed us gray employment. It showed us informal economies of 12% in Spain that don't show up on any formal notion because the census isn't picking that up. And when you have that kind of data, you can make much better decisions about where to focus your resources. We thought we could apply that same process to Indonesia. Indonesia has the world's second largest number of Twitter users. Who knows why? So we thought we could apply the same fingerprint system. Turns out in Indonesia, the models don't work in that same way, but what we did find is that you can correlate Twitter behavior to Human Development Index for education. So the HDI is based on a household survey. It costs millions of dollars to do, and it takes you a year or two, minimum. You can get basically the same information about where schools are good or bad, where students are learning and not learning, by looking at Twitter data. This time it took 1 week, and it cost $2,000. So that's the type of stuff that we can do if we're looking at unstructured data and information. And that's pretty interesting to us. It let us do this during Ebola. Okay, so we were looking at those communities in Sierra Leone. In the green area up in Kafu, you had 13 cases of Ebola. This is looking just at people's cell phone records, just at their cell phone data. So you've got a place with some cases of Ebola and a place with no Ebola in Freetown. And you say, where are people going to move? Where do we put up health supply tents? Where do we put up medical centers and communications facilities? Because we don't know where people from Kafu are going to go. You look at mobility data and you see that 41% of people from Kafu go to one part of Freetown. So that east area, those three wards, you actually look at that mobility data even more granularly, and you see that they go to one particular cell tower location, that green area. And what we saw is that 2 weeks later, you found two cases of Ebola right next to that. That's the power of real-time information and real-time data for better planning and better action. And that's incredibly important for us as an organization that has the small amount of resources that I described before. If you extend that, you can take information about travel from Amadeus. You can take information from IBM, which owns the weather company, and many other partners that we have, and start combining them and looking at things like, where is Zika going to spread? And the models don't fit exactly the same way. The model for Zika is different to the model from Ebola. But what we do know is that as we're starting to build up these stores of data as UNICEF, we have access to intuitions now at a speed that was totally inconceivable 5 years ago. So the last thing I wanted to talk about was how we're funding this work and how we're looking for new projects. And this is really a question to all of you and a discussion to have as well. We've seen that we can fund specific pieces of work, like UReport, through our own team. But we see over and over again that the best projects, the best companies are starting in places that we wouldn't necessarily expect. So we started a venture fund that does small amounts of capital investment in early stage tech startups that are open source. And we have a specific requirement that that company cannot be registered in the US or Europe or Japan, in the traditional places where a VC fund might look, but has to be in the places that we think the problems are most acute. And we look at the areas between huge needs, so needs of a billion people, and these markets that are growing, like the market around data and data science and machine learning, where we think that those small investments can start to shape a world that looks different to the way it does today. For example, we know that there are a ton of big companies looking at drones for transport. Everything from Airbus and Boeing to DHL is trying to figure out how drones are going to drive a transport economy. They're coming up against regulations in more developed economies, and they're struggling for figuring out how the technology will really work. So the first test of drones in South Africa was to deliver Domino's pizza. Okay, it works. You can now get, you could for some time get a Domino's pizza delivered to you in South Africa by drone. But does it really work in the most difficult to reach places, the places where that population growth is going to be the greatest, the places where you can actually make a lot of money if you have a smart business? And the answer is probably not. Like, if you test pizza delivery in Cape Town, that doesn't necessarily work in Blantyre in Malawi, in southern Malawi. So here we've actually invested and we've built the first drone and UAV testing corridor in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, for testing drones for humanitarian work. And it's in Malawi. We launched it about 3 weeks ago. And it's a 60 by 20 kilometer corridor, which allows us to work with companies to test out their products in difficult environments. Because if you don't build it where the users are, the thing doesn't work very well. We look at questions of identity. A third of children in the world don't have identity. If you're a refugee child, that is acutely worse. This is my grandmother's refugee card from 1940s Germany, and my great-grandmother. And she wrote her name with three crosses because she couldn't write. The card today, if you're a Syrian refugee going through Europe, you fill out the same card, which is pathetic. I mean, we're using, it looks basically the same. And you fill it out five times on average as you go from country to country. But you have one number that identifies you the whole way. If you're a 15-year-old from Syria, you have one number, it's not your phone number, that identifies you the whole way. And it's your WhatsApp number that you registered on WhatsApp on in Damascus or in Aleppo when things were normal. And that number, you discard SIM cards, but that WhatsApp number locates you the whole way. So we think that there's a huge space around the future of identity, and whether it's looking at solutions like distributed ledgers and blockchain, or simple things that people are already using to identify themselves. Having 250 friends on Facebook probably meets the KYC requirements of a bank, the Know Your Customer requirements, pretty well for basic loans. So can we look at those technologies to grant identity, even if it's not granted in a sovereign way? In Uganda, where we've seen that great increase in birth registration, up to 70% now, this is the output and visualization layer in the Ministry of Health. Also not a great refresh rate. So even in a place where we're changing the ability to do birth registration at a very basic level, our ability to take that information and process it and turn it into anything, UNICEF is great at turning things into PDFs, like I think we're the best producer of PDFs in the world, which essentially is the most amazing way to make data meaningless to anybody. Is there a way to take all of this information that we're collecting and use it in real time, apply tools, neural networks, and machine learning to it to figure out what's actually happening, because our brains are little, and use that to make decisions in real time? Is there a way to send money more quickly? So we know that in Kenya, you've got M-Pesa, system for sending money over text message. M-Pesa has something like 99% name recognition across Kenya. It's an incredible way to send money by SMS. They just published a study, 3 weeks ago, that shows that the use of M-Pesa has actually raised GDP in Kenya by 2% in the communities that it's being used most. You've got in Nigeria 300,000 Bitcoin merchants, 300,000 people who are accepting Bitcoin in Nigeria. That came out of nowhere. So things are changing very quickly, and how can we use that growth to make sure that we're getting money to where it's most needed, and we're able to track it and see what's happening in real time? And finally, this whole space around things that you wear or things that you talk to. On the bottom left here, you've got a mid-upper arm circumference monitor. So remember I talked at the beginning about all of the kids who are going to be affected by climate change and not get the right food. If you don't get the right nutrition as a kid, you don't grow. Your body doesn't grow very well. So you become physically stunted. But your brain, as the most hungry organ, also becomes stunted. It doesn't grow as well either. And what you see is that if you have a kid who's moderately malnourished, you can get them back to health quite quickly. Severely malnourished is much more difficult. And then you create a whole generation of young people who aren't able to be creative and to solve problems in the way that they could if they had basic access to nutrition. And this little band, it's a traditional UNICEF wearable. So if it's in the green area, the mid-upper arm of a kid doesn't change very much between 0 and 5 years. It's a pretty good measure of a kid's nutrition. If that's in the green, your kid is a fat little baby, very healthy. You've got a happy baby. If it's in the yellow, your kid is moderately malnourished, which means they're not getting the right nutrients, but you can get them back to health. And if it's in the red, and I usually have one of these, I don't have them now, but if it's in the red, so the circumference of the red is about 5 centimeters, that's the upper arm circumference, that kid is severely malnourished and needs immediate care. And this is a device that we developed in the 70s to help a semi-literate health worker understand the condition of the patient that they were working with very quickly. And it's super. It's a very effective device, but it doesn't have an API, right? Like, it doesn't connect very well. This thing on the baby's neck is a product that we invested in called Cushy Baby. It takes all the patient's health records, uses NFC to store them on a little chip, and allows a doctor or health worker to access medical records dynamically in real time. And the thing costs $7. In India. 2 years ago, it cost $30. In 2 years, it will cost $2, and then it'll be free. And that lets us move information in the way that we have, but faster and better. So those are the type of things that we're looking at for this venture fund, and those are the areas that we see technology moving at a speed that we can attack the types of problems that I described. If you're interested in that, I'd encourage you to take a look at that website. You can see the first set of 5 investments that we've made, and I'm happy to chat more about them in a Q&A period. But I wanted to thank you very much for coming out this evening and listening to the work of our team. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So we have time for questions now. So anybody in the room who has urgent questions? We have 2 microphones that are going through the room. There is a question here on the third row. Fourth row.
There's a mic coming behind you.
Thank you for the talk. My question is about birth registration in Uganda. What proofs from a mother are required, like, to make sure that she's registering her actual child, not like a fake identity? Thank you.
Yeah, very few. You need the baby's fingerprints. You fill out a long form piece of paper, birth certificate, which has, like in any country, mother's name, father's name, date of birth, and all of that. And it's signed by a medical health worker who's part of the Ministry of Health system. So among those 3 data sets, you have enough to identify that kid. It's as reliable as any birth registration system. And we haven't, like, nobody's really cracked the biometric stuff on birth registration yet. There are a lot of groups working on fingerprints of infants and how to resolve those kind of in real time, but it's still not great.
Hello, good evening. There are some NGOs that start moving from the third countries to the first countries, like, for example, Emergency has opened some hospitals in Italy recently. I'm wondering if you thought if some of the approaches developed for by UNICEF can be actually applied also in the first and the second countries, and how effective they could be.
Yeah, so we've just launched UReport in Ireland, and we're launching it in Germany, and in a few other countries that I don't want to ruin the surprise on. The idea of having young people engage with government in a proactive fashion and identify and work on issues together is pertinent everywhere in the world. So we've had huge amounts of demand on that system. I went to a doctor in New York like 3 weeks ago, and I had to physically bring my health records from my other doctor, like by paper. They don't walk down the street with paper documents from one doctor to another, which is crazy to me. I'd love to see a system like MTRAC put into place there. I think the data science work, I mean, that example that I showed is from Spain, and that data science can be applied everywhere in the world. And it may be that we prove things out more quickly in certain areas, but I think that the idea of having real-time information for better governance is applicable in any place that you're looking at smart cities or making dumb cities smart or helping people live their lives better.
First of all, thank you so much for your talk. It was very inspirational, I think. I would like just to ask for some insight of this open code approach, and maybe for the ones that we are not doing anything related with data, more like maybe materials or the, new, more physical inventions, let's say. How can we take this approach? Thank you.
So, I think two parts in that question. On the second part, our venture fund looks at any new technology that is open source and that is trying to solve big problems for humanity. It just happens that who's doing like hardware stuff? Who's working on hardware or hardware things? Okay, one person.
Nobody else is working.
Anything with hardware, IoT, connected devices, physical computing. Okay, two people. Great. Well, you two people know that hardware is really hard, right? We've had much less success in the space of hardware and physical things because it's so difficult, and we haven't cracked that egg yet. But I think that we'll see more investments, and as I showed, there's already one. But any company can apply for the fund, and it doesn't matter if it's data or hardware. The open source thing is very important for us because we're actually looking at helping companies make money and be open source. So it's not like just give your stuff out and then go and be poor, but we're working with companies to build business cases around their open source code that allow them to actually prosper and grow at a pretty good rate.
Thank you very much, very impressive. I wonder if you have faced any confidentiality, data confidentiality, and individual privacy issues, because you're using cell phone data, let's say, for people chatting or moving or stuff like that.
That's a very good question. The answer is yes. The data that we use that I showed for communities and community mobility in times of disease, et cetera, is all accessed at aggregate level. So it's never about it's virtually impossible to trace that back to an individual user. We work very hard at that. We don't want to carry that risk. So we make the data less good as we get it from network operators, and we do that all through governments. So it's never us going around, but we as UNICEF are able to make that negotiation. But we purposefully make the data dirtier so that it's harder to trace it back to an individual. With things like UReport, these are all opt-in systems, so people opt to be in it, they can always leave. And I struggle with that question every day. What do you do in a country? We've got now two million plus UReporters. I mean, this is potentially a very dangerous environment, but the future is like a dangerous and scary place. So I think that the best thing that we can do is to be very honest about those problems and work with our users to figure out what their comfort level is. Like, we've given away all of our data to Facebook already. We're so comfortable with it. We want those shoes. So I think we're trying to figure out how to make sure our users are comfortable and that they have a knowledge about what their data is being used for.
Thank you for your very nice talk. My question is quite short. Do you have an open position in your team?
If you go to that wonderful website right there, which is not there anymore, if you go to unicefstories.org, you can see the type of positions that we're hiring for. So there, look at that magic. That's real-time data. If you go to that website. So we're just hiring for a bunch of data scientists and research scientists. We're hiring for a drone and UAV coordinator in Malawi, which is an amazing job to actually run that corridor for a year. It's a team that's always hiring and growing, and specifically in the space of science and technology, I think this year will be a big growth one. But check that out. All of our jobs are posted on there, and if they're on there, they're actual real jobs.
Hi, so I thought the slide with the very different budgets between your team or UNICEF in general and China was very interesting. And clearly you managed to do a lot with very little. How effective are the other players in foreign aid at spending their money, and how do the learnings from your team spread to those other organizations?
That's a mean question to ask me when I'm on stage. The way to see how effective somebody is to see if they're putting up real-time data about their work. I don't trust anything that comes out in a yearly report. I don't believe in that. There's no trust. There's no confidence on my part in a yearly or bi-yearly report. The venture fund publishes real-time data about GitHub commits, about usage, about transactions on all of the things that we invest in. I think that's quite compelling, because any of our LPs, our investors, can see what's happening. Just like if you look at your mutual fund website, you can see all the stocks in real time. You can't divest from them, but you can see them. So the answer is, I think that you have to look at whether or not a group, an international organization, is publishing stuff in real time, or if they're like publishing a very nice printed document. There is a UN Innovation Network, which we founded and co-chair, which is bringing together a lot of people in the UN around this. And we're trying to be helpful to other organizations and agencies, and I wish we had more time to do that.
I have a quick question. Since you mentioned trust, and with your report, the data goes through multiple channels before it gets to the UNICEF. What kind of trust measures that being taken while the data is in transit between government, network operators, until it gets to the UNICEF?
The biggest trust layer that we've built, to be very honest there, is a human trust layer. We work very, very hard on constructing the discussions on UReport in a way that will not put anybody in danger. And we work on that, so we're not asking, these are not political discussions, they're not dangerous discussions, these are questions where we have government and buy-in from other sectors to make changes in certain areas, and they want data and information. So there's no security that you can build for SMS as a protocol. You just can't. It's totally compromised, and anything you send over a text message is read by like 30 different groups right now. So that's one thing. We work very hard in UReport to make sure that the kind of conversations we're building are positive conversations that result in real action and that aren't antagonistic to anybody. And that's a human engineering problem, not a technical one.
Thank you very much. Sir, I have a question. Maybe it's not a technical question. I'm very interested in the UNICEF organization. So what is the requirement of being a member of it?
I don't know. They made me get a master's degree before they would give me my current job, which I thought was sort of ridiculous. There's UNICEF mothership, and then our team has a very different approach to requirements. So we hire people who are amazing in their fields and who can, I mean, we hire people who then go and work for Google, we hire people from Google, from Facebook, and so on. So we hire top level people. The way to get into any big international, I don't know why anybody would want to get into a big international organization, but if you do, you need a master's degree. It needs to be printed on the right paper, because there's actually somebody who feels the little gold stamp, seriously, to see if it's real. But my recommendation is always to start with things that you're good at and things that you can make a difference in, because all these organizations and governments are trying to figure out this new world, which you guys know so well, or at least you know parts of so well. And if you can be a translator between these old systems and the way they do things and this emerging, totally different way of thinking, because it is going to crash around people's heads. It is going to change so much to have access to real-time data about everything. If you can be that translator, you can create a place for yourself and create a job that didn't exist 5 years ago. That's what I did.
What is something that you, like either on a daily basis or some type of problem that you wish was just fixed? Like the
all of them.
Well, I know that, but I mean like something that keeps coming up, like as like, if this was fixed, then this would make things so much easier.
That's a very good question. I have my sort of easy answer to that is like, I wish things could go faster. I wish we'd be building these things more quickly. I think that a more developed version of that answer is that I wish that we could get people who are making decisions now to trust the fact that things are changing more quickly than they can imagine. And we don't have the proof points for that. So if you take data about like Zika spread, and you're saying you're getting this from real-time travel data, weather data, and Zika epidemic data, we can show you where Zika is going to go. You will have a lot of people in the international world being like, yeah, but is that based on, is that like accurate? Is that statistically valid? And you have those questions a lot. And I think the more proof points we have, and this goes back to the need for translators, the more proof points we have that make sense to decision makers about how this can positively benefit their work, the better we're able to do that work.
Any questions? Okay, I have two questions. So, first one, so we discussed a lot about big progress based on the big data and data analysis and everything, and clearly you did big revolutions in this. So what is the part of for devices in this? What is the ratio of investment in innovation between what is more cloud computing and database and everything and things that are development of devices, and what are the big innovation that you are expecting in terms of devices for kids and things like this, physical devices? Yeah.
I have to work on what we're good at as a team, and we've just failed over and over with devices. So there's a whole different way of figuring out capital expenses and where you put the money and what sort of research framework you need around devices. And there's also this weird thing that like people fall in love with a device in a way that they don't fall in love with software. Like, it's a very weird person who's like, I love that code base. Like, that looks really nice to me. But you build this thing that's like a wearable for whatever or a sensor for whatever, and people are like, that's great, can you make it blue? You know, I love that, I just wish it was a different color. And that's really dangerous because it for us, that's actually dropped out like 20 layers of development and prototyping because of this sort of like the fetishization of object with physical. So that's just us, that's our team, and it's not to say that there aren't groups that are looking at devices, but our expertise over and over again is not in physical things, even though we keep trying little gestures. I think we're going to be looking a lot at renewables over the next year or two, which is going to get us into some device level stuff, and I think we are going to be making some investments in IoT wearable things, but really in trying to get manufacturers to make the right devices that we can then get data from.
Okay, good. Question here? One in question. Microphone? Where is the microphone? Okay, we have a question here.
Thank you. I have a question that is not really the main point, but I was wondering if the schools were shut down so that students won't get together and the disease would spread out more, how can you send them to houses? Wouldn't that be dangerous for them?
Yeah, so the schools were shut down because the government, the Ministry of Education, in this particular case, very much believed, so we didn't know anything about Ebola. That's like the first thing to say is that in that crisis, we were going in with that stuff that I showed you, and that's like what we all had. We didn't know very much about the disease. The schools were shut down because that was the immediate reaction of a group of decision makers that said, like, this is gonna be safest. It turns out if you look at data about quarantines, that's not necessarily correct. That the most dangerous thing that you can do in an epidemic is to cut off access to information for people. It's not to keep them from meeting. It's not necessarily intuitive, but when you have a school, you bring kids together and you're like, hey, everybody, wash your hands. Hey, let's check your temperature. Hey, let's do this, this, and this. And those are all, those, it turns out that that set of activities is more beneficial than the risk of contagion in the case of Ebola. Because Ebola is transmitted in a very specific way, you have to have physical symptoms. You can't get it from just like touching somebody who touched it. Like, there has to be a specific set of things that happen. And in that particular disease, being in a school or an office building is actually better for the network effect of reducing spread of that disease. That's not true of other diseases. So Zika, that's not true, because Zika, the mosquitoes are day biters. They bite during the day. So if you have one, and if you get bitten and you go to work and another one bites you and they bite your friend gets infected. So it's different in different diseases, but in that particular case, the school thing wasn't the best intuition.
Thank you for the inspiring talk. So I read about a project that you did not mention in your presentation, which is digital drums. Can you briefly tell us about that?
Yeah, doesn't that sound like hardware? Yeah, it failed. Really big. No. So digital drums, the digital drums were digital kiosks for learning. And what we tried to do was build a kiosk device that kids could access Wikipedia and learning content in Uganda. And we built several versions of it. The first were super engineered in New York. Those broke. The second were very engineered in South Africa. Those broke. The third were built by car mechanics out of oil barrels, drums, in Uganda. And those worked for about a year. But there's a whole bunch of problems with putting kiosks and physical things into places where there's not a business around them. And the problem is that there's nothing that sustains it. And this is all very intuitive now, but in 2010 it wasn't, or not to me. So we put out about 300 of them, and they worked for varying lengths of time. But we were never able to make sure that they worked longer, that they would be kept up after they, if something broke. And we were never able to make sure that the kids who really needed to access content, which are particularly girls, were able to access it, because there's always like a group of dudes standing around playing games or doing whatever and pushing other kids away. So that didn't work, but the concept of getting education into difficult to reach areas has grown, and what we're doing now is working on platforms like Colibri, which came out of Khan Academy, and we're investing quite a bit of money and time in it as a content delivery platform with all of the learnings that we had from the digital drum, but then looking at a mobile phone as your hardware, because that thing is there in an environment and you don't have to like ship something in and upkeep it and all of that.
Actually, thank you very much for a great presentation. You touched a little bit on my question now. And my job here at KAUST is similar to yours in the sense that behavioral change is very important for me. And I work in the security field where we try to change the behavior of our KAUSTians here to be more aware about security matters around the internet. And I was wondering if awareness had played a role in your campaign, or if the result of analyzing that data brought you to a conclusion that awareness could help further your cause.
Yeah, I think for us, we see a huge link between, so you can actually use technology to solve a lot of the problems technology creates. And if you do it in a way that's about creating authentic conversations, you can create good awareness. If you do it in a way that's pushy and where we're trying to like shout something out, it doesn't work at all. And I'm sure that you've run into the same issue. So for us, we build awareness by building up conversations with young people. We never, I hope we never send out just like spam messages saying do this or do that or do that. But it's really about these conversations that are built up with them as user testers and then implemented with them as users. And that gives a very different flow to that awareness conversation. So you can, we raised voluntary testing for HIV in Zambia from 20% to 40%, the number of people who go get a test at a clinic, by using U-Report to have conversations about health. But that meant having conversations that were built with the people who were the end users, because when I tried to write the first messages on that, like I got literally one response from 70,000 users. And that response was like, you sound really old. Like, this is super weird. Stop texting me. When you build it with the actual users, you have a totally different dynamic, and we see that over and over again.
If you don't mind, go with second question. So this is mainly about like remote areas, you know, places with low access or no access to internet or cell phone. So are these like just forgotten places? And maybe the second related question is, you know, probably there's like projects from, you know, some major companies like Google and Facebook to provide internet to, you know, such areas. So can you comment, if you can comment on that as well? Thank you.
Sure. So I went to a very fancy restaurant a month ago. And when I went outside, I saw one of the waiters on his break with a flip phone in New York, right? And so that guy with his phone versus me with my iPhone, the difference in our ability to access information and turn that into action is immeasurable. If I want to look for a job, if I want to look for better healthcare, if I want to look up information, I can do that like that. So a place like Malawi, maybe the contrast is turned up really high, but those problems are everywhere in the world. And it's just that we maybe don't see them in a big city because we're tripping over ourselves so much. And we don't go to the poor areas of a big city and we don't see what people face. But every problem that I've described in like a developing country, which is a stupid set of words anyway, every one of those issues is an issue everywhere in the world. And it's just sometimes harder to see it. We work very closely with Facebook and Google on both of their big infrastructure projects. We're also working with a bunch of satellite providers that are working more in the nanosat space on provision of content and information. And what we try to do is to prove the point that they can make a business in a certain way and let them then follow that point with all of the money that they have.
Great talk. I want to ask how to remain focused and responsive while generating too much data, rather than drawing in the large quantity of data.
Yeah, I have a hard time remaining focused anyway. And when we see all of this data, like I get very excited about it and all the opportunities that it has. We try to hire amazing people and data scientists with specific research lines who are focused on their type of work and let them do their job and connect them to companies that can drive that forward. So I would eat all of the cake of the big data if I could, but I can't. And so we really try to hire teams that are working in a smart way on specific sets of projects like the unemployment project and let them, and then like I try to not distract them. That's like a big part of my job is to not distract our team.
Okay, so thank you very much. I think we had a very, very long Q&A session already, so I will save my second question for later. I wanted to thank you again for your great talk. So this is the official trophy from the WT that is in 2020 signed to...
Fantastic.